Hi guys. It's Gordon Ramsay, back for another hour, this time from London. There's a lot of exciting things happening in 2016. New restaurants, a mobile game, so ask me anything. And for my American fans, try not to overcook your burgers next weekend. Can you call me a ducking donkey please? Come on, usage digitized, you've got too much ducking time on your hands, you donkey. Get a grip. In your opinion, what are 5 dishes that everyone needs to know how to cook? Everyone enjoys a great burger, so that's really important. You get that really smart blend. Burger would be number 1. A healthy breakfast. Whether it's poached eggs, smashed avocado, or an amazing omelette. Now that is crucial. That's dish number 2, a really good breakfast. Number 3 would be a braising dish. Like a braised short rib, because it's the kind of thing you can cook on a Monday and still eat on Friday. So a braising dish, whether it's braised short rib, tri-tip, just something really cool braised. Then from a healthy point of view, a chicken dish, in terms of a white protein, would be a go-to favorite with a chicken. Whether it's a sauteed chicken or even a delicious marinade with chicken Caesar salad. Finally, for my 5th dish, I would turn that into some amazing cake. It could be a blondie or a chocolate brownie, something you can give as a gift. Taking amazing desserts as a gift to somebody and eating it with them is so much more enjoyable than buying them a scarf, or a jumper, or a pair of socks. Spending 3 or 4 hours making this thing, and spending hundreds of dollars on ingredients, and doing something magical, is far more exciting than buying a ducking jumper that you know they aren't going to wear. Hi, Gordon. You're my hero. My girlfriend is typically not much of an adventurous eater. She is, however, curious to try Kasumazu or maggot cheese. Having witnessed you try it on the F word, I have to ask, is she bonkers or am I? So, Kasumazu is a very strong cheese. If she's not a very adventurous eater, I don't think she's going to be too keen having maggots in her mouth. But, I don't want to just talk about your willy. Here's the thing. In order to get these taste buds moving faster, have a bit of fun with this. Blindfold her, and have some fun with spooning her some sort of strange, awkward, sexy foods, and you'll see that confidence flying away, that she'll get so much more exciting with all flavors. But blindfold her, have some fun with it, and play with it. You'll see she'll get more adventurous. You just got insulted, and then given sex advice by Gordon Ducking Ramsay. You can die now. Hey Gordon, huge fan. Quick question, if you were on death row, what are you ordering for your last meal? That's a really good question, because for the last 10 years I've been asked that about 2000 ducking times. I'm never gonna answer that question. A. I'm not that bad to be on death row, and B. If it was my last supper, ask me that question in 40 years time, when I'm 90 years of age, I can't go to the bathroom properly, and I need my ass wiped on a regular basis. So, yeah. Gym for decades time, and I may be close to answering that question, because I could be nearing my last supper. Until now, duck off. I'm miles away. Wow, it really is you. Every time the man speaks, I fall in love. What is the dumbest trend in food that you thought would not have lasted, but has? I think foam should be used for shaving, not go on top of food. Because when a foam hits a plate, unless you've eaten it within 3 or 4 seconds, at the end it looks like sort of toxic scum on a stagnant pool. So I started with foams in the 90s, and I'm still amazed that they're around now. So we need to get rid of the foam, and keep foam for shaving. But spray can whipped cream is still okay, right? Sincerely, a North American with no shame. What do you use a microwave for? What do I use a microwave for? That's a bloody good question. There's an amazing way of drying herbs in a microwave. You get a plate, plastic wrap, and then rub a whole basil leaf in just a touch of olive oil, and then lay it on the tin foil. Press for 45 seconds in the microwave. They come out crispy. It's almost like shallots fried, but they get such a quick temperature, it dies and crisps out the basil leaves within seconds. So I do use a microwave, only to sort of lightly fry basil, tarragon leaves without deep fat frying. It's incredible. Correct me if I'm wrong, but wouldn't tin foil be the wrong thing to use in a microwave? Gordon can do whatever the duck he wants. Cue thousands of Redditors frantically trying to put out kitchen fires. Why Gordon, why? engulfed in flames. Hi Mr. Ramsay. I recently went to your restaurant Gordon Ramsay Steak at Paris in Las Vegas. I was wondering, exactly how much influence do you hold there? Is it a namesake, or do you supervise all of the production and menu, etc? So opening the steakhouse in Vegas was one of the most daunting and dangerous things I've ever done. The team are brilliant. I visit my steakhouse about 12 times a year, and we cook dinner only. So, I grew up to speed about 15 years ago, when I first started coming to the US about how well they did steakhouses. I sat, watched, absorbed, and learned, and when I got the chance to open Gordon Ramsay Steak, we actually have an impact on the scene. So yeah, there's my DNA. The standard is incredible, the staff is friendly, but it's got that really cool Britannia feel, and I'm all over it like a rash. I talk to them on a daily basis through email, but that restaurant means such a lot to me personally that, yeah, I spend a lot of time there. So yeah, that's definitely the real deal. Going there soon. I can't wait to try your meat. Hi Gordon. Do you ever just wander into a restaurant looking for a bite to eat? If so, how do you decide where to go? If so, when you wander in, do the staff visibly begin shutting themselves? You know I love going to restaurants and I love going to enjoy myself without having to work at them. The first thing they look at when they see me standing in reception: A. Is there a camera crew behind him? B. Did you book? And if you did you book under your ducking name? I'm very lucky, because the majority of the restaurants I go to, they go above and beyond. It makes me a little bit embarrassed. I'm so grateful. First thing I want to do is go to the kitchen and say hi to the team. When I've had a great meal, I give them as much love as I can on social media. I'm very proud, even if it's chefs who work for me. Just to let the world know, we have over 15 million reach between all our social media figs. If I see someone in the middle of Washington or the middle of Barcelona at a tapas bar, I'll be the first to put it out there on social media. I just had a fantastic lunch or dinner, check this restaurant out. Sometimes, I've gone into restaurants where the chefs have been somewhat pissed off and disgruntled and nothing happens for 40 minutes. My worry is my food going through the dishwasher 3 or 4 times? Is some chef seeking revenge? But I can smell that shit a mile away. 9 times out of 10, it's an exciting place to be in. Sometimes, I've sort of jumped to a one course, just to get the hell out of there, because things aren't going too well. In this video, you're seen offering a job to an inmate, after he beat you in an onion slicing contest. I was wondering if you could offer a follow-up on this. Did he ever get the job? Also, I think it's a wonderful thing you did that day. So going into the prisons and working with offenders that regret what they've done, I'm a firm believer that everyone deserves a second chance. So, I did offer him a job. Secondly, he re-offered it within days of coming out. And that's the issue for me in prisons, and that's why I went in and set up a documentary called Bad Boy Bakery, where we created a bakery on the inside to sell on the outside. Because these offenders need to come back out into society better equipped, more suitable, more confident, and perhaps even higher skilled than when they went in there in the first place. So, sometimes you come across those individuals that are less fortunate than others, and they deserve that second chance. So I offered him a job. I was excited to have him by my side, and the offer is still open today providing he comes back into society better placed. Please tell me his offense didn't involve slicing things up. What, in your opinion, is the easiest dish to get wrong, and how can you avoid it? Also, what was the most pleasantly surprised you've ever been with something you've been served, whether it was the place you were eating, the name of the dish, etc. So the easiest dish to turn into something awful would be, for me, cooking a great steak. Serving a New York strip, for instance. For me, the most important thing is taking it out of the fridge 15 minutes before you actually use it, so it gets to room temperature. Season it properly, and then cook it once it's up to room temperature. And then the biggest mistake that people make once they've cooked a steak instantly is they cut into the middle of it. You've got to let the steak rest for as long as you cook it. That way, it's plump, it's juicier, and don't worry about the temperature being piping hot, but just the value and the difference in flavor once you've let a New York strip rest for 6 or 7 minutes. The difference is night and day. So, great sear, but let it rest. food that really pleasantly surprised me more than anything. You know, I'm all about dressings and vinaigrettes, especially this time of year. So, making a great salad is making sure that you dry those leaves, because if the salad is damp, you'll never taste that vinaigrette. So there's so many certain ways, with fresh honey, basil, lots of herbs and vinaigrettes, that can make it so much more interesting. So I'm all about that kind of lightness, especially over these next couple of months. Do you have any thoughts on subscription services such as Blue Apron, which ship pre-portioned ingredients and invite customers to cook their own meals at home with minimal preparation or prior cooking knowledge? Are they ultimately helpful for the home cooking industry, or are they just a passing gimmick? That's a really great question. Last month we worked with Blue Apron on MasterChef when they were setting the contestants a task. So I think, when you're up against it, time-wise, and you're short of time and you haven't got time to prep, it's a great idea to sort of increase the confidence in your cooking whenever it's laid out in front of you. So, I look at the Blue Apron as almost like a mystery box challenge. So I welcome the idea. Would I use it 6 or 7 nights a week? No. But, to start off with, understanding your portion control, no wastage, and getting up to speed with a combination of ingredients, it's a really good idea, but once you've used it 4 or 5 times, that should give you sufficient confidence to go out and buy your own ingredients, and be a little more experimental, and have a little bit more fun with it. So yeah, good idea, and it's a great way of gaining a lot of confidence in cooking when everything is laid out in front of you. How many of your fellow citizens have you screamed at after the Brexit vote? I screamed at the whole government, because the difference in staying or exiting was 1.7 million people, and I don't think, you know, this whole catastrophic scenario should be based on just 1.7 million votes, in terms of the difference between staying and going. I thought it was a little bit unfair that the much older generation in this country that aren't dictating the economy or have gone into retirement and lived their life, they've made it more difficult for the younger generation coming through. And so it was a bit unfair because those votes, no disrespect, weren't really important to the future of this country when they've lived their life and are now in retirement. So, that was really awkward. And then, everyone thought that this money would be going to the NHS. Because it's 350 million. Nobody was told about the devastation and the ramifications of it. It was a lot more difficult, but with such a tiny majority winning that vote, it should never have been in those people's power to determine what was happening with this country. Because, well, the majority of votes were nowhere near big enough when you look at the consequences.